With this episode, I'm feeling a shameful void. We are finally going acoustic for the first time in the BTR channel. Maybe late, but we are starting in grand style. My inseparable guitar friend Giacomo Bagorda has very generously lent me a vintage original Martin D-28 from 1953, another important piece from his collection, a real chunk of history that deserves our attention. The Martin Guitar Company is generally considered the most respected manufacturer of flat-top acoustics. The company introduced through the years important innovations that helped to shape the modern flat-top guitar as we know it today. The logo on the headstock proudly shows the year 1833. That's when our story begins. The German luthier Christian Friedrich Martin, descendant of a family of violin makers, migrated from Saxony to the United States and opened a music shop in New York City. 6 years later, he moved to Nazareth in Pennsylvania, where he focused on guitar making. Martin became the first relevant guitar manufacturer of the United States. He gave rise to a family-owned and operated business that lasts to this day through 6 generations. It is fair to say that C.F. Martin brought guitar culture to the United States. In fact, before he arrived, guitars in America were essentially European imports. Christian Friedrich's construction technique reached maturity in about 10 years of activity. In 1843, he made a guitar for Madame de Gogny, an acclaimed Spanish guitar virtuoso of the time. She could be considered the first signature artist of our era. For her guitar, C.F. Martin devised the X bracing. This system, still widely in use today, improves the structural stability, allowing to increase the size of the body. It also creates a more articulated top vibration to the benefit of tone. By 1852, the model names conform to a standard system, consisting in 2 separate codes joined by a dash. The first code indicates the size of the body. The second code is a number to indicate the style, meaning the type of woods employed and ornamentation kind. Besides a few exceptions, the higher the number, the more decorative ornamentation and more prestigious woods are implied. As for the first part of the model designation, the size code, a larger number indicates a smaller body. By 1854, the offer ranged from the junior size 5 to the bigger concert size 0 or not. In the following years, guitarists began to perform in larger halls, demanding more volume and stronger low-end response. To meet their demand, a larger body size with double O or double not designation was introduced in 1858. A triple O or triple not code arrived with the new century. For instance, an O-28 model from 1870 has O-body size, which was considered appropriate for a public performance, and O-28 timber arrangement and ornamentation, one of Martin's main styles. At the time, the 28 style featured Brazilian rosewood back and sides, and Adirondack spruce top, with genuine ivory herringbone body binding around the top edge. All guitars with the same prefix, in this case zero or ho, are the same size and only differ in wood and ornamentation. All the guitars with the same style designation, in our example 28, share exactly the same timbers and ornamentation, regardless of their size and shape.
For the sea from England shore I was condemned to sail.
Notoriously, in 2015, a rare original, priceless Martin from the 1870s, was hired by the Martin Museum to the production staff of the movie The Hateful Eight by Quentin Tarantino.
Give me that guitar. Music, time's over.
Whoa. They are even more rare since. Martin requested to have the pieces returned for a restoration, but sadly realized that no fixing was possible. The actress Jennifer Jason Leigh, who was aware of the historical value of the instrument, appeared visibly upset for the accident. She said that Quentin Tarantino gave her a vintage Martin guitar from the 1880s as a present to make it right. By 1873, over a dozen craftsmen were employed. In 1898, the Martin Company began to mark their production with serial numbers. They had esteemed that they had produced roughly 8,000 instruments in the previous 65 years since their foundation, so they started at that number. The company kept, through the decades, detailed records of their entire production, honoring typical Teutonic love for precision and accuracy. The same serial number system, just a plain sequence of consecutive numbers, is still in use today. In 2004, the millionth guitar came out of the Martin factory, receiving a 7-digit serial number. In 1916, Frank Henry Martin, grandson of the founder, began to experiment a larger body, destined to become the most influential guitar body design ever produced. This larger body shape was named Dreadnought, after the larger class of battleships of the day. Their name means fear nothing. Initially, the Dreadnought guitars were produced with Ditson brand, exclusively for the Oliver Ditson Company, a major music store chain with shops in New York, Philadelphia, and Boston. Meanwhile, Hawaiian music was starting to influence American players. Hawaiian musicians needed more volume and adopted steel strings. In 1922, Martin introduced the first production model with steel strings. The X bracing revealed to be perfectly indicated for the increased tension. By 1928, steel strings became the standard on all models, and gut strings were offered as an option. Steel string guitars quickly started to cross over to other music styles, like Delta blues and country. In 1931, after the Ditson Company closed, Martin finally started to produce Dreadnoughts sporting a Martin brand on the headstock, officially marketed as D-size models. These models initially didn't catch on. It was general belief that bodies larger than triple O would tend to sound too bassy. In the mid-1930s, guitars started to play a more significant role in the bands. Therefore, artists started asking for louder instruments for their live and radio performances. The demand for dreadnoughts progressively increased and larger quantities were produced. That's how we arrive to the specific model we are examining, the D-28. The D prefix indicates the dreadnought size, and the 28 code designates the popular style of decoration and timber arrangement in use since 1870. The 28 style had actually slight variations through time. For example, by 1918, it was finally time to realize that elephants are more important than guitar binding, so they replaced genuine ivory with white celluloid. At the beginning of 1934, the company introduced necks with 14 frets clear of the body, updating the traditional 12 frets design. The 14 fret neck would soon become the standard for the American guitar industry. From the late 1930s, the use of heavier strings suggested to shift the X bracing towards the bridge area. In 1944, the bracing also becomes bulkier, without the sophisticated scalloping work found on earlier models. After the war, the demand increased dramatically, commanding to speed up the production. Martin cuts back on some meticulous crafted finishes. As we see on Giacomo's 1953 D-28, the slotted diamond fingerboard inlays give way to simpler dot markers. A narrow chain link back stripe replaces the more elaborate zipper pattern, and plain black and white plastic binding replaces the cool-looking herringbone pattern. Therefore, the pre-war D-28s, nicknamed herringbones, retain higher collector's value, especially those with 14 fret neck. Of course, our 1953 D-28 still sports many highly desirable and valuable features, including woods of the finest quality, Brazilian rosewood for back and sides, Sitka spruce top, one-piece Honduras mahogany neck, ebony fretboard and bridge. Tuners are Cluson K500 waffle back. Groover automatics were adopted from 1958. Guitars produced since the 1920s used an ebony bar inside the neck to compensate steel string tension. By 1934, a steel T-bar would be used instead. During World War II, the entire steel production was absorbed by the war industry. This forced a short comeback to ebony reinforcement. After the war, the steel T-bar was reintroduced, as on this guitar. A square steel tube was used from 1967, and proper adjustable truss rods arrived in 1985. It's interesting to note that the headstock has more rounded corners than earlier D models. That's because the original factory molds tended to wear out through years of heavy use. Thank you. The serial number is stamped on the neck block inside the body. The stamp also indicates the model name, as in use since the late 1920s. 1953 serials range from 1345-01 to 1413-44. This guitar carries number 134966, so I would assume that it was almost certainly made in January. As it might seem, recording a great guitar tone without a high-quality microphone, it's like driving a Formula One car on a rough road. That's why I'm relying on a Bringer's multi-deluxe studio microphone, definitely up to the task. Like many companies, Bringer's started as a one-man business. Its founder, Teo Pizzolante, is not only a qualified sound engineer and audio designer, but also a tone-discerning guitar player. Theo has been traveling with dozens of bands, has worked for years as resident sound technicians in music clubs, and released a good bunch of albums as studio producer. He makes use of his multifaceted experience to build high-end studio microphones, 100% handcrafted in Italy. The multi-deluxe model is a true studio workhorse. It has impressive signal-to-noise ratio. Clean and precise, it's particularly indicated for vocals or a vintage Martin guitar. Despite the introduction of more body sizes, the D-28 remained a classic. Dreadnought has become the most popular type of acoustic guitar, providing excellent tonal balance and efficient sound projection thanks to its large body. Our D-28 boasts great clarity and attack, strong bass response, deep dynamics and impressive sustain. It's a versatile instrument that can cleverly range through a variety of music styles with both strumming and fingerstyle playing. Countless acclaimed musicians have embraced a Martin Dreadnought. The vintage D-18 models used by Elvis Presley and Kurt Cobain are obvious examples. Even focusing on the D-28 only, there are still too many relevant testimonials to name them all. A Martin D-28 is present in the arsenal of many recording artists, either for performing or for songwriting. Jimmy Page, David Gilmour, and Nick Drake, to name a few. Johnny Cash used to say, "I'm not a guitarist, I just strum and sing." When he was at his farm, he strummed on a 1971 Martin D-28 that he called Bon Aqua. It was his personal guitar, now exposed at the National Music Museum in South Dakota. The 1963 D-28 that Bob Dylan used at the concert for Bangladesh was sold at auction in 2017 for near $400,000. Six figures number also for the 1941 D-28 used by Jerry Garcia of the Grateful Dead.
Starry, starry night, paint your palette blue and gray.
When I was 4, my mom offered to buy me the first record of my life. She assumed that I would choose a children's song. Well, I chose Vincent by Don McLean, a heartfelt ballad dedicated to Van Gogh. At the time, I was far from realized that McLean, on the cover, was proudly showing a Martin D-28. He remained a faithful Martin testimonial through the years and says to own over 50 Martin guitars. Steven Stills beats him, owning a whole impressive collection of vintage Martins. John Martin, spelled with Y, used a D-28 with a D'Armond sound hole pickup. Probably something very similar was formerly mounted on Giacomo's guitar, since it shows somewhere in that area. Neil Young in 1973 acquired the legendary 1941 D-28, once belonged to Hank Williams and to his father, Hank Williams Sr. The instrument that he nicknamed Hank inspired the song This Old Guitar, where Neil sings, "The more I play it, the better it sounds.
The more I play it, the better it sounds."
Exactly the same words that Giacomo said when he brought me his guitar. Often guitarists favor no-frills instruments. The rather plain-looking D-28 is a classic example. Owning a vintage Martin D-28 brings the responsibility of being a custodian of such extraordinary historical and cultural legacy. Please subscribe now and click the bell to keep in touch. Feel free to join the Facebook group Bob Stone Review and follow our Instagram profile. Your participation with comments and feedback is the only fuel to keep the BTR channel going.